When the wind blows from the ocean toward the shore, the ocean surface becomes rough and the waves lose their form. But when the wind shifts, blowing from the land to the ocean comes alive and the waves gain their incredible shape. You can't see the offshore winds, but you can see how they change the waves. You can't see God, but you can see how he changes lives. Tim Curren is by far one of the most innovative surfers to come along in many years. His ability to perform aerial maneuvers on command has made him a standout on the world tour of surfing.
Surfing to me is my life, and after the many years of surfing, I just have such a love for it, and now I get paid to travel the world and have fun and see what God's created.
My first aerial was when I was 12 years old and I was going down the line. I had more speed than I ever have, and just so happened that the backwash hit the wave right as I hit the lip, and it threw me so high. I don't know how, it just launched me way up in the air. And I remember being up in the air, looking down going, oh my gosh, I am in the air and my feet are perfectly on the board, and I'm flying, and I come down and I eat it, and I just like remember coming up just going, that is the best feeling in surfing. I was just like, that's it.
Tim had the most supportive family that any surfer could ask for. They not only introduced him to the ocean, but also to the maker of the waves.
I accepted Jesus into my heart when I was 5 years old, and basically it was my mom and dad sitting down with me one night on the couch and just telling me all that God offers and how he loves me so much, and how if I accept him into my heart that I'll go to heaven and everything's fine, you know. And when you're a little kid, you're just like, yeah, that sounds cool, man. Win-win, you know, situation. And I remember they're like, we don't want to force it upon you, so go and, you know, just come back, think about it. And I went into my room for about 5 minutes. And I'm like, yeah, it sounds too easy, you know? And I went out and prayed with them, and ever since then, I've just tried to be the best I can and live for God. Surfing, money, everything that I have comes nowhere close to the feeling that God gives me when I'm right on with Him. And so it's awesome. If you have the opportunity to feel something that's better than anything out there, might as well try it, you know, and see for yourself. And He'll do things in your life that you'll know He's real, you know, so many things.
Tom Curren started surfing professionally in 1982 and went on to win 3 world titles. He is one of the most popular surfers of all time.
I believe that God's hand was in, you know, my life, and that's how I did well. That's what I believe. And even when I kind of wasn't really following Bible and things like that, there's still, you know, some of the residual good that was in the beginning that, you know, carried me through. My basic belief was in God and, you know, Jesus and the Bible, but I didn't really like go out and surf for God or things like that. So I was kind of a little bit divided.
Tom went through some tough times in his life, and as a result, he turned to God for help and developed a deeper relationship with his Creator.
For me, the turning point kind of happened when I was driving in the car listening to the radio and heard a preacher. Plus, you know, just going to some meetings and stuff. There is like a change, you know, you feel different. You know, it's not just your emotions playing tricks on you and stuff. It does take work, but there has to be some kind of a, you know, change in direction, I think. I'm just kind of a witness or whatever that even if you mess up, you have another chance, you know. So that's kind of my story, I guess. Start and come back. Start and come back. Start and come back. Changing what you know. Every time forever.
The sin that lives in me. Yeah, I took an L to set me free still. What I do, I don't wanna do. And so goes the story. Oh.
Tita is Brazil's top female surfer and is rated one of the top 10 in the world. She's small, but her size doesn't stop her from charging the big waves of the Hawaiian and Tahitian islands.
I'm from Brazil, the north. I love Hawaii. After Hawaii, I love Tahiti. Taupo is left. Oh, go for the reef.
Tita is from an extremely poor family. Before her mother died, when she was only 5, she told her to do one thing really well. Tita's one thing was surfing. She learned to surf on a door that her dad cut for her in the shape of a surfboard. She surfed on that door for 5 years and started winning contests on it until she was able to buy a real board.
Tita Taveres getting that last ride, a 7.75, the highest wave of the heat, brings home the bacon.
Through Tita's professional surfing career, she's been able to pull her family out of poverty.
My family has loved me. Thanks me.
Tita tells the young people of Brazil who look up to her to turn away from drugs and instead to turn to Jesus.
One day Jesus talked to me, you know, no hears, he need here. All the time, yeah, thanks Jesus. That's right. Yeah. A little more than I can give, a little more than I deserve on earth. This holiness I can earn, it's a little more than I can give, a little more.
Bryan grew up in La Jolla, California. Through his pro surfing career, he has been able to travel all over the world.
One of my closest friends is Toshi Oyama from Japan, and he just makes me laugh. And I was able to go and visit him in Japan when I went over there for a surf contest.
Konnichiwa! Jesus loves who?
When we got to the surf contest, the waves were really small and blown out, and so the conditions weren't the best, but being in Japan was so much fun, and seeing a different culture is just amazing. And then we were able to stop off at Hiroshima on our way back and learn a little bit more about what went on there.
When I was young, I heard about Hiroshima. I had fear of death. But after I believed Jesus, Jesus set me free from fear of death.
When Bryan was 17, he began to wonder if there was more to life than what he was experiencing.
I was checking out this church where they were giving away free pizza and they were singing songs. And I was just like, what are these weird people doing singing songs about God? And I didn't understand one thing they were talking about. But as I'd come home from a party or being with my friends or whatever in high school, and I was by myself, about to go to sleep, I started thinking a little bit about what I'd heard that week at church. I'd been thinking about the songs they were singing to some God that loved me. And I started to realize that He did love me. After I gave my life to God, He gave me my pro surfing career, and I won a contest, and I started getting sponsors, and all these things were happening. But more importantly, I had this peace in my life. I just had a fulfillment in my heart, and that was amazing. And I started to see things differently in my life. I started to see people differently. When there was someone who was rich, I sometimes look at them like they were poor because they didn't have God. Or I'd see some homeless guy on the street, and instead of just looking at him like, oh, what, you know, he's a bum, I'd start seeing him as someone who God loves. I don't know, things were changing. I could see what people needed in their lives, and I'd want to fulfill it, where before I could care less. But I started to care, and it was fun giving. And it's been fun giving over these past 7 years.
In recent years, some of the world's best surfers have come from Florida. Among them is C.T. Taylor.
I think God made waves for surfers. I think that He knew before there was even surfers that there was going to be surfing. I sense God when I'm out surfing, and I enjoy God when I'm out surfing. Like, I'm just thankful. I started surfing at Playa Linda Beach and in Cocoa Beach in Florida. And just had like good friends that would take me around that were older, and you know, would drag me out when the waves were too big for me and tell me what to do and stuff, pretty much. But that's really all the help I had. I just really learned just being out there and just having fun, and just was determined to be good. You know, I always wanted to be a professional surfer. It was kind of my dream. I came home one day and I had all these messages on my answer machine, like 15 people had called me. And I could tell something pretty big, pretty major happened because of how excited they were for me. And then I found out that I got a cover shot.
CT aggressively pursues his surfing career, but the most important aspect of CT's life is his relationship with God. He was only 14 years old. Some of his friends invited him to a meeting that changed his life forever.
I went to this Bible study. It was like a surfer fellowship. You know, a few of my friends were there. And it wasn't like I was radically saved from some kind of drug addiction or anything like that. It kind of almost seemed uneventful, you know? But I did feel that tug on my heart, like, hey, this is right, you know? This is like, you know, God is real. He's not fake or anything. He's not something in my imagination. He's not something that people have made up. And I just really felt His truth, really, and So I gave my life to him. You know, I asked him to forgive me of my sins and come in my heart. It's really that simple. From that point, then I just sought God, you know. I just would read my Bible and pray and just try to do my best. I just see how God's never, like, took his hand off of me. Like, he's just always been there. Drift away. Now together we are stronger. Can't see hope, but it lasts longer. The thorns on trees and words that sting. Faithful are his wounds.
John Carper is one of the top surfboard shapers in the industry. Many of the world's best surfers exclusively use JC Hawaii surfboards. John and his family host a popular Bible study in their home in Hawaii. Several years ago, though, John found himself in a deep emotional pit.
The more I got successful, the more people were saying I was cool. Actually, the more empty I was feeling. And I went through, I suppose, like a deep depression. I thought about myself, looked at myself, and I go, I'm nothing. Everybody thinks I'm something, but I'm nothing. Inside, I was hollow.
John remembered some friends who had told him about Jesus years before. He decided to give God a chance.
I kept going across this one little old church and said, Jesus loves you on the top. And then I kept on going, well, not that kind of church. That's not the kind I want to go to. But I finally went and ended up going in there. And I walked in and people were playing tambourines and singing. And I had no idea about this stuff. And up there on the stage was a guy singing. His name was Ernie Cruz. He was the biggest, strongest man in Hawaii. Oh, you know, I hadn't seen him for years. But I remember seeing how mean this guy, and vicious and bad and tough. And, you know, I kind of thought that was cool then, you know. But he was up there playing his guitar, and he's crying and singing songs to Jesus. I don't think anything's affected me like that in my life. And I just go, this is it. I'm here. Whatever's going on here, I want this, and I want as much of it as I can get. And I started coming, just, you know, it took me a while to break down the barriers because I had a lot of pride, and God had his way, and I gave my heart to the Lord then. Still, he's still working on me. It's not easy for me. I'm still kind of rough on the edges, but he just brought me to a better life. That's all I can say, a better quality life.
Skip started surfing in the late 50s and was part of the genesis of California's surfing culture. As a shaper, he is a leader in the new era of longboarding.
In my early days, it was just kind of going surfing and having fun. I actually got out of the competition aspect of it before it really became a professional circuit where money was involved and so forth. That period I call the BC period, which was before cash.
Skip saw many of his friends fall prey to traps like drug and alcohol abuse. His life was headed in the same direction until he took a walk along a deserted beach in France.
Took this long walk down and I was just bawling like a baby, you know, reaching out to God, and came back a different person. I came back up the beach, I had a new relationship with him, and I tried to pursue that ever since then. I know about waves because I experienced it. Well, I've had enough time with Jesus now that I've experienced him, and I've seen him working, and I've seen the miracles he does. A lot of people probably think the life of a Christian is really boring and, you know, goody-goody, and there's no fun, but I'll tell you, there's more fun in life with God than there ever was partying and carrying on. Why wouldn't you just want to say yes, come into my life and help me along?
In the mid-70s, Chris O'Rourke was rising in the ranks of the surfing world, beating California's top professionals at the age of 15. Young Joey Brand was also growing in recognition, but after seeing Chris surf, his goals seemed unattainable.
I wanted to be the best surfer in California, and I remember thinking, this guy is better than I am.
I mean, he won the U.S. Open three times in a row, and he was a promoter's dream. You know, everybody wanted a piece of Chris.
He was my main subject, and I could tell he was going to go places. He was by far the best surfer I had ever seen from California. In 1976, we had a very memorable large south swell, and actually Jerry Lopez came and surfed Wind and Sea during that swell, and he saw Chris O'Rourke and also referred to him as the best California surfer he had ever seen.
Chris grew up surfing Wind and Sea in La Jolla, which is known for producing great surfers. Wind and Sea also had the reputation of being one of the most localized surf spots in the United States.
There was a lot of localism, and if anybody hassled the local, they'd definitely get ganged up upon, you know. It's just like gangs, inland gangs, but it was the gang at the beach, you know, and Chris had a reputation as being that ringleader.
And of course, this all goes back to the Pump House Gang back in the 60s when Butch Van Arsdalen and that whole crew were notorious for upholding the localism atmosphere around Wind and Sea.
We would were like a pack of hyenas, and we would shred or terrorize anybody who threatened the pack, you know, and Chris was very vocal in that. I mean, I can remember times where Chris and I and some of our buds would have tipped over a Volkswagen van and set it on fire because the guys weren't from La Jolla.
One of Chris's closest friends was Brew Briggs, another top surfer from Windensea. Brew became a strong believer in Christ and began to boldly share the message of God's love with everyone at Windensea.
But they wouldn't respond. And it was then that I realized that it isn't just my words they're going to respond to. It's got to be God. It's got to be the Lord working in their lives. And I didn't stop telling them, but I went into a lot of prayer.
Chris O'Rourke was one of the people who heard Brew share the message about Jesus. However, he wouldn't respond because he wasn't willing to let God change his life. When Chris was 18 years old, his seemingly perfect life came to a sudden stop when he returned from a surf contest in Australia.
His wife noticed after he came back that he had a lump on his neck, and basically that started the whole scenario where he went to the hospital, found out what it was. It was cancer. It was Hodgkin's disease, and I think it was, unfortunately, at a pretty advanced stage.
Chris was told by doctors that he had only 3 months to live. He started chemotherapy treatments and began a long and hard fight against cancer.
I remember thinking, and what else would you expect from a silly, selfish surfer at 17? But I just remember thinking, boy, that's a tough break for him, but it's a good break for me.
He had a good sense of humor about his condition, but he also, I think initially especially, identified with, first of all, his surfing ability and his personality and his appearance, secondly, and had that all taken away from him.
With death at his doorstep, Chris prayed with his friend Brew and asked God to forgive him and change his life.
Chris was like going, how do you know you're saved? He knows he's dying. He knows he's got a cancer and he wants to make sure. I said, read the Bible. And even though he'd accepted Jesus, when he started reading the Bible, I remember the day after he read a lot of the Bible, he said, Brew, I read the Bible and you know what? I've been bad. And I said, yeah, but he's died for you, you know, that you can be saved.
But then we met Chris on the beach one day, all us kids, and he was all, we're all, oh my gosh, he's gonna say something. He's all, hey, I want you guys to come to church with us on Sunday, with me and my wife. And we were just like, okay. And we were so stoked that he even looked at us and talked to us. You know, he could have said, hey, I want you guys to jump off the cliff on Sunday at 3. We're like, okay, great, we'll be there. And then like 2 nights later, he invited us over to his house. Like, man, we're at Chris O'Rourke's house. We're looking at the walls, there's pictures of surf, trophies. We're like, oh my gosh. And his wife starts going, so have you guys made Jesus your Lord and Savior? And we're like, what? Sure, what do we do? Yeah, whatever you tell us to do, we'll do. Not really caring the implications or anything, you know. We wanted to be cool, like Chris was cool, you know. Whatever he was into, we wanted to be into. And then they started talking through the night more and more, Chris and his wife, and it was really radical. I remember distinctly thinking at first, I'm in awe of this person in this place and this where I'm at. And it switched to like, I was just talking to a normal person and all of a sudden I was in awe of who he was talking about. Because Chris was like the most revered and respected guy. And he's telling me now who he respects and reveres is Jesus. And he has this relationship with Jesus he was trying to explain to us. He didn't know much at the time either. He was having a hard time articulating all the intricacies of what had happened in his life. He'd only been a Christian a couple weeks, you know. And he was just telling us, and he was trying to get it across to us, and the words weren't probably correct in everything he was saying, and he didn't have a working knowledge of the Bible and all that, but we got the point. We all just went. We all felt, we said, I remember we all looked at each other and went, this is weird, man. I feel like we're floating right now. And his wife saw, that's the Holy Spirit. We're all, whoa, that's cool. What is it? You know, we thought it was a magic trick.
He revealed to me that he was a Christian and that how bad he wanted me to become one. He shared it like he wanted to tell me about some incredible secret spot he had found. It was like, hey man, come on. You know, it's great. I want you to have it.
Then we went to church Sunday. Pastor gave an altar call. Didn't know that's what it was called at the time. You know, he said all the things that Chris was trying to say, he was able to articulate them all. And it all made sense, you know. God sent his son Jesus and the world turned against him and Jesus died for our sins. He just laid it out real simple in about half an hour and we all went, right, let's go forward. So I went forward, got my little beginner Bible, and went forward the next 12 weeks just to make sure. And then finally that pastor at that church was like, you don't have to keep coming up. I'm like, I want to. He's like, oh, you can then. You can just keep coming.
He had lost all his hair, and he was just basically skin stretched over a skeleton. But when I walked in, the presence of God was so strong in the room, and I didn't know he had become a Christian. But I knew, somehow I knew God was in there. And I could barely stand in the room. My knees began to shake. And I looked at him, and he looked at me with those big blue eyes, you know, that he had, and he just said, bro, I'm worried about you. I thought, you got it all backwards, man. You're the one dying, you know? I should be worried about you. And he goes, no, don't worry about me. I'm going to paradise. I've got eternal life in Jesus. And right now, you got nothing but hell to look forward to. And bro, I love you, and I want you to know the King. I want you to know the Savior. And he grabbed a hold of my hand. I could barely take it. The Spirit of God was so strong in the room. And I went, whoa, if I stay in here much longer, I'm gonna burst, you know? And I just sort of backpedaled out of the room and got the heck out of that hospital. And as great as it was to see Chris at that moment, because I hadn't seen him in maybe a year and a half, 2 years, I was terrified of what I was confronted with in terms of knowing that that God he was talking about was real. And I could feel him knocking on the door to my heart.
A lot of kids were being drawn to Chris and Chris's relationship with Christ and Chris reaching out to kids. But this Chris Aaron's fellow, he knew full well that Chris wasn't going to be able to handle all these kids coming around asking questions. So Chris stepped in, Aaron's, Chris O'Rourke's friend, he was an older guy, and he started doing formal kind of Bible studies and answering all our questions.
I remember one night in particular, there were probably, I would say 15 of them sitting around the house, and I looked around and there's these 14-year-old to 16-year-old kids holding each other and crying and saying that they loved each other. And it was tremendous how the change that came over that group.
But he started getting really sick. He had a couple operations. I remember he had one operation where they put like a plate in his head and they said, you know, you'll probably never walk again. You'll never surf again. And sure enough, he did surf again.
I remember his first wave, and he just pulled through right hooker. He actually got a little tube and just screamed out, praise God, I can surf again. And he got better and better and better at it, and he became much better, I would say, than the average surfer.
He would grab onto like our legs after he'd catch a wave. We'd wait for him on the inside. He'd kick out, and then I'd say, okay, grab my leg, and then I'd paddle him back out. And he would just hold on. And you'd just be towing him out. And here was this guy who was on top of the world, the legendary surfer and everything like that, had everything going for him, beautiful wife, he just had a baby, he was, you know, just ripping. He was the number one surfer in the state, he was going to Australia for contests, and here he was just totally degraded to this position where now he had to grab onto my foot to paddle out, and he would just surf and he could barely do it, and I knew it just killed him to see everybody ripping and going fast. That was really painful. It was just like, whoa. And yet in the midst of all that, his reaction wasn't to destroy and be really mean and bitter, but he developed a relationship with Christ, you know, made peace with God, and then went out and brought a bunch of kids and showed them God too, you know, which is pretty much an incredible legacy, you know.
He told me one time, he said, he had read in the Bible where it said, talking about Jesus, it said, by his stripes we were healed, and he said, well, maybe by my pain, some people can be healed. He says, it's just a little pain, but maybe by my pain, some people can be healed.
I can remember after Chris was converted, and I had been converted as well, I can remember Chris paddling up to complete strangers, guys that we would have terrorized, you know, several years before, and just shaking their hand and say, hey, bro, what's your name? Do you know that the Lord loves you? And it's like, I saw Chris really come alive in those days.
He was just really a changed person when it came to localism. It was hard for him because he's like, gosh, I want to do something. I want to say something. But no, you know, no, I'm not going to do that.
Joey Buran was now a star in the surfing world and had become known as California's best surfer.
Somebody that Chris O'Rourke really didn't like at all was Joey Buran.
of all things I remember from my pro career, one of the clearest memories was the plane ride with Chris O'Rourke, because it was much larger than my surfing career. It had to do with God's calling on my life.
Joey Baran was everything that Chris had been, which was proud and arrogant and gonna set the world on fire and look out, I'm coming through. Same, cut from the same cloth. And Chris was sick and Joey wasn't. Joey was a little bit younger and he didn't like it one little bit.
I remember not so much exactly his words, but he began to share his faith in Jesus Christ with me.
It was a 747, a full 747. I think there's about 250 seats on one of those things. And as God would have it, those two were going to sit right next to each other for 17 hours or whatever the plane ride takes. It was a direct flight to Australia.
And at this time, you know, it wasn't anything I wanted to hear. It was just, you know, the whole world revolves around Joey Brand. I'm the California kid. You're dying. You need Jesus. I'm not, and I don't. And that was sort of my perspective. But Chris was right there, and he was just sharing things about the Lord and what God had done in his life through his cancer and all this stuff. And, you know, like, pretty typical, you just kind of getting, you know, I was getting convicted, and I remember, I was like, I got to get away from this guy. And I got up from my seat. I was like, I got to use the bathroom. And I got up from my seat, and I walked, you know, the back of the plane. I'm looking for an empty seat. It just was not an empty seat on this flight. There was nowhere for me to sit except next to Chris O'Rourke. And so I'm like, oh, what am I going to do? This guy's going to give me the Jesus rap all the way to Australia. This is like an, you know, 18-hour flight to Australia with a stopover in Hawaii. I'm like, I'm stuck next to a guy who's dying telling me about Jesus. And I mean, it was like the last thing, situation I wanted to be in. And I ended up having to sit in that seat. And I remember, you know, Chris just, he wouldn't let up. It wasn't rude, but he just kept, well, what are you going to do, Joey, when you're not the best surfer in California? I'm like, well, I don't know. I haven't really thought about it. You know, those are the type of questions he was asking me. He's like, has it all been fulfilling for you, you know, that you've gone on? I'm like, I don't know. Why are you asking me that? You know, I mean, it was like, it was that kind of stuff. And then I remember him asking me to put lotion on his back because chemo dries out your skin. And I just remember just like, oh, man. I was like, it's kind of weird, you know. I don't want to do that. But O'Rourke took his shirt off. And I put this, like, you know, just basic lotion, you know, moisturizing lotion on his back. And I just remember when I, like, touching his back, that it was like touching a dead person. I mean, his body really was just so stiff. And it was like the Lord was making me touch eternity. I was touching death, and I was touching the grave, and I never had before. And then we got to Australia, and a day later, he collapsed on the scaffolding.
He was really close to dying, and he knew it. And I was sort of in a state of denial. I didn't want to believe it. And he said, Lynn, I'm really going to die, but it's okay. And I said, how could it be okay? How could it be okay? All you've known these last few years is pain and suffering and cancer. And he kind of smiled. I thought, why is he smiling? And he said, Lynn, these have been the happiest years of my life since I found Jesus. I really think if I hadn't gotten cancer, I wouldn't have found Jesus. So getting cancer is the best thing that could ever have happened to me. And these last 4 years that I've had cancer have been the best years of my life. Before that, I was dead. And now, even with all this pain, he said, I'm alive and I know the Lord and I know where I'm going. And it just makes life wonderful.
Chris died in 1981. His family and friends gathered together and spread his ashes in the waves at Wimminsee.
I've not seen localism. I've seen glimpses of it, but I have not seen it, you know, manifest itself to the extent that it did in those old days after Chris got saved. There's some guys who are still trying to carry the torch and be the big bullies down there, but for the most part, the Lord broke that thing in the back.
Peter King and I and a couple other kids, we stopped it. I mean, when it came to be our turn for the localism thing, I think over time that I can look at it, Chris's message must have had a really big input because that's where it stopped.
He had a major impact on my life and coming to Jesus Christ, because 2 years later, when I gave my life to Christ, I could look back at that divine appointment on that plane with Chris O'Rourke and know that the Lord's hand was in it. And I praise God for Chris's faithfulness. And in a lot of ways, I feel like even to this day, what God is doing through my life is an extension of what he did through Chris O'Rourke's life. And you know, that's what the Church of Jesus Christ is all about. The fruit goes on. And Chris may have been in eternity now for, it's been 15, 18 years, whatever, since he died. But his fruit goes on even through my life and other people's lives like mine. And I praise God for it, and I thank God for Chris O'Rourke.
We can't see God, but we can see how he has changed the lives of these surfers. God is able to change each one of our lives as well. He loves us more than we can possibly imagine. Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life." He also said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father but by me." There is only one way that leads to heaven, and that is by believing in Jesus Christ, who died on the cross so our sins may be forgiven. He also rose from the dead 3 days later to prove that he has victory over death and that his words were true. If you are ready to trust God with your life, ask him to forgive you for the things you've done wrong, and ask Jesus to come into your heart and change your life forever. Change are blown across my life. Living life in charge. Never thought that I could crash so hard like a falling star.
So slow, forget.